Welcome to RDH TV. My name is Morten Valeur and I come from Denmark. This fly is a Goddard Sedge, or my version of a Goddard Sedge, and this will be the first fly we will be tying today. It's a really versatile pattern for fishing for grayling, trout and rainbow trout. I use it mainly places where you have the big caddis called Prygnea grandis. And this is an effective pattern, even though if you don't have any risers. It's a good searcher pattern and it will attract even the big trout. It's a really, really time consuming fly to do. It's a lot of deer hair in there and you need a lot of cutting as well. It's a pattern you can tie from size 6 down to size maybe 16 or 18. But I prefer using it in the big sizes, trying to imitate the big caddis flies we have in, at least in Scandinavia, called the Prygnea grandis. And it's a really important fly, and it's a searcher pattern, you can say. It always attracts fish to the surface when you're fishing a big dry fly like this. But as I said, it's a time-consuming pattern, so it will take some time to do it, and there's some techniques involved in this as well. The hook I'm using is a Chemco 200R. It's a slightly curved hook. You can use a traditional streamer hook as well. I just think that it looks nicer on this one. It's pretty important that the hook is quite stiff and steady, because we are working a lot with deer hair. And when I said deer hair, you can do it with deer hair. That's a really nice material to work with. But the one I prefer is actually antelope. It's a slightly thicker hair. The quality at the tips is not the same as in deer. On deer they are even and they're more smoothly tapered. On antelope they're normally cut off and not as nice. But we don't need the tips on this fly. And the hair itself spins really, really nice. So I prefer to use antelope instead of deer hair. But deer hair, as I said, will work fine as well. Use a pretty thick tying thread. I use a 10-0 or 8-0. This is a 10-0. You can use Kevlar thread, you can use gel spun as well. I just use my 10-0 because I know it quite well, so I feel confident using it. I'll just start the tying down here. We always need to have a bare hook when we try to work with deer hair. Start a little bit further back than you should think. So we need to put on a little bit of tie thread and a little bit of varnish as well, to be sure that the deer has not, when I'm pushing the deer hair back, it doesn't, so I can't push it all the way down in the hook bend. So I need to be sure that this is sitting there, which I think it does now. Just move the rest of the varnish. So, and now it all starts. It's a lot of work to do this, but it's worthwhile. Caught a lot of big trout on this fly, and I probably will in the future as well. So I don't mind spending the time doing this. The important thing is, one of the important things is that you need to select a bunch of hair that's the right thickness. If you make it too big, it will not spin. If you make it too small, it will take a lot of time to do this. So make a bunch that's normally, a general rule you can say is take a bunch that's almost the thickness of a pen, a normal writing pen. Then you will have approximately the right thickness of the bunch. The next thing you need to do, you need to remove all these small fibers that's sitting here down here in the bottom of the hair that's closest to the skin. There's always a few thin hair in there and you need to remove that. This is really messy, but as I said, it's worthwhile. Okay, the first bunch is ready. I prepared it. I need to spin it. What you do here, you take the bunch, put it in here, two loose wraps. Be careful with the point of the hook. Two loose wraps. I put the bunch in not at the same position as the hook, but on the like this. And then what you need to do here is, again as I did on the bullet head caddis, you need speed. Don't do it too slow, and then just move the thread forward. Don't try to avoid tying down the hair. If you try to avoid it, I'm quite sure that you do tie down some hair. Just move the thread forward and you'll be fine. That was the first bunch of hair. Just need to see if it's placed correctly. It is. And I tried to pull the fibers backwards. The problem is here that you have the hook. If you didn't have the hook or the hook pointed, this would be much, much easier. So the first couple of bunches is the most difficult part. So. Okay, next bunch. Same procedure. Cut off a bunch, thickness of a pen. Remove the small fibers. It's ready. Same procedure. Tie in. Try to avoid to tie down any of the hairs from the first bunch. This can be pretty tricky in the beginning, but I'm sure if you do this a couple of times, you'll get the grip. Like that. Same procedure again. Speed is needed. Take the thread forward. And then now we pull this back. Securely fasten it. And try to pinch it as much as you can. And here's the important thing. If I hadn't put on the varnish in the beginning, I'd probably be able to push all the hair down in the hook bend. And we don't want to do that. If you put in so much effort with the hair now, we don't want to push it back in the hook bend. And I avoid that by putting on the varnish in the beginning. Okay. Next bunch. And that's actually what you're doing until you reach the hook eye. You just do this, maybe, I don't know how many bunches, 10 bunches maybe. And the harder the body gets, the better the fly will float. So put as many bunches in there as you can. Same procedure, remove the small fibers. Put in the bunch. Try not to secure any of the hair from the first bunch. Two wraps, loose wraps. Be ready, spin. And pull back. There might be a hair or two that's not secured correctly, but that doesn't really matter. There's so much hair in here, so that's not really a big issue. For some reason I tried to pick it out anyhow. That's just I can't help it. Here we go. I'm getting closer and closer to the hook eye now, and probably can put in 2, maybe 3 bunches more. And now you need to be more and more careful about when you put in the hair. I can kind of hold the thread with my tip of my finger there and try to secure the bunch as good as possible, because you don't have a lot of room now to do the spinning, and sometimes this will not work, but you can try at least to avoid some of the incidents by putting the thread in the correct place. You can see now this only maybe, yeah, what, how much have we left here? Two millimeters or something like that. And I think I still want a small bunch in there, even though I need to put in the hackle as well. I wouldn't mind having just one more bunch of hair here. I don't know how many bunches I got in here, maybe 10, something like that. It's and you need to do that to make the body really firm and tight, and the fly will float like a cork. And that's what we need to make it do. I think the small, but the bunch in the last bunch here must be a little smaller, because I don't have that much room here, so just a little one, a small bunch, like this, maybe 1/3 of the thickness of a pen. Same procedure as before. Pull the hair backwards as much as possible. It's not easy, but you can do it maybe a little bit. And I'll just try to secure this just with one turn of thread, and then do like that. That's a bit, it's not as good as the other technique, but when we don't have much space, this will work okay. Okay, I think we are done actually. There's still 1.5 millimeter left here for the CDC hackle, which we'll put in when I have cut hair on this one. Make a few wraps. Press and pull the hair backwards so it's tightly packed. And then we just finish the fly for now and start the cutting. Just a few half turns here. Just to be sure that it's not unwrapping, I'll just put on a little bit of varnish here before I start cutting the fly. Here we are. Looks like a big, ugly rat, but after a few hours of trimming, it will be nice. What we need to do now is to cut the fly. Actually, we need to cut off most of the hair again. It seems a bit, little bit unfair to do that, but that's really what we need to do. The shape I would like to achieve is something like this from this. And it takes some time to do, and you actually shouldn't do this at home, and maybe when you're visiting friends, or do it outside. It's really messy, but it's, yeah, it's a job you need to do. What I start with here, you can do it either with scissors, or you can do it with a razor blade. I prefer to do it with a scissor because I'm used to doing that. I see a lot of good fly tires using razors as well, and that's of course okay to do. I always start with the bottom first, so the hook point is now upwards, and I make the first cut here. I can look at the hook eye, which is the point I have to refer to. So I start by cutting off a lot of hair. Not cutting in the hook, that's not a good thing to do. And I need to make sure that all the, and it's flat on the underneath, and it's in the correct position before I move forward. So cut off here. Start cutting off on the side as well. When you start doing this. You have put in so much time with putting in all the bunches of hair and all that. So you, in the beginning, you tend to be a little bit too scared to cut, but as you go by, you master this and you get better and better at doing it. So now I got reasonable flat underneath here, and I can grab the hook point or hook bend as well. So now I can start the cutting on the upper side of the fly, and I use the hook eye as a reference point. Actually, I put my scissors against the hook eye to have something to lean on. And you need to take a look at the fly now and then to be sure that that everything is looking as you want it to. It should end up like a caddis fly, nothing, not like something else. So you need to take care. And then you can removing some of the hair just by tapping the hook eye, so you can get all the loose fibers out. Then you need to check, is this okay? Yes, it looks okay. Maybe I need to take off a little bit on this side. I think it's important that you still leave a lot of space so you can hook the fish. It's not, if you have too little space between the hair and the hook point, you'll end up not hooking the fish when they take the fly. So you need to cut down in the hair as much as possible. This is really tightly packed, so it's not that easy. And that's how it should be, actually. Tightly packed. Then I need to remove some of the hair here in the back. It's a little bit too long. And normally, if you look at the caddis, it looks like this. The wings are cut in that direction. I need to do the same thing on this one. I just need to do it correctly, like that. As big as possible. I prefer these flies really, really big. The bigger the better. This should be a really good mouthful for the trout or grayling or whichever fish that want to eat this. I think I'll cut off a little bit more here. And the same thing from the sides. It's a little triangular. I think we're almost done. You can do this for hours and you'll still be able to find a hair or two that you want to cut off. But at some point you just need to stop. And I think I'm getting close to that point now, actually. Yes, I think I'm happy. Okay, the only thing I need to do now is to put in the CDC hackle, which will be the head of the caddis, just in front of, behind the hook eye and between the hook eye and the deer hair or antelope hair. So that's what we're going to do now. I put the fly back in the vise now, and I just need to take a small look at it, maybe remove a little bit more hair here and there, but as I said early on, it's about time to stop this and put on the hackle. But you can sometimes you see things when you put the fly back in the vise, and you can see, oh, there's some hair there and something like that, so just put in a little effort to remove the last few fibers that you want to get rid of. I try to make the hook gape a little, or the space between the hook point and the body a little bit bigger, so I'm more sure that I hook the fish when I get the chance. I think this should be fine. Okay. Put on a black tying thread now. Because this should be the head of the fly. And it's darker than the rest of the body, and just need to put it as far back as possible. I'll make a small dubbing loop. Putting the dubbing reel. And I'll take some two big or large CDC feathers with long fibers. Use the select CDC, which have the longest fibers. You can put this in a clamp if you want to, or you can just, this is not really that complicated. I just use my fingers, but if you prefer to use your, if you have a Mark Petichang clamp, for example, that will work fine. But you can also just do it with your fingers. Cut off the fibers. Put it in the dubbing thread. Oh, dubbing loop. Like that. You want to place them as close to the hook as possible. You need both long fibers and short fibers here, actually, because the long fibers will be legs on the caddisfly, and the shorter one will be the head, you can say. Put the fibers in here so you have maybe 1/3 on the left side and 2/3 on the other side. And then just spin. Like that. And then you wrap this as tight as you can, trying to pull the fibers backwards as you go forward with the thread with CDC fibers in. This is a really neat finish on this fly, I think. You can use a normal hen haggle as well if you want to, as John Goddard did on his original fly, nothing wrong with that. I just think that CDC works so fine with the rest of this fly. It's a neat way to finish the fly. And it looks really lifelike, in my opinion. Always some hair you can cut off. Like that. We're almost done. Just make the few wraps and press the CDC fibers backwards and finish with a finish knot, or as I do, with a few half turns. And I'll have a look, see that everything is fine. You can see that the fibers look like legs on the caddis or sedge. I'll just cut off the upper part because that's how they look, and leave the longer ones on the sides and below on the underside of the hook. Here we are. I think the fly is finished. And you can see how the fibers are sitting here. Put on some varnish and we're done.